Bam!
Welcome everyone, happy Friday to you. Welcome to cohort 9, Capstone Pitches. Ooh, I'm weirdly echoing on my own computer over there. Mute on there, right? That would be weird. Thanks for coming out. A couple of things. One is if you have a cell phone, if you would put it on vibrate or silent or something similar to that. If you have some other setting, quiet. Snooze, broken, broken, you might not do anything. That would be great. If you are a non-FIEAN and are interested in getting a tour of the place or learning anything more about the program, you can talk to anybody here, but Sarah and I particularly would be happy to talk to you, as well as if you'd like a tour of the building and to find out a little bit more, we'll be happy to do that afterwards when these presentations end, so feel free to find one of us as well. And if the other faculty and staff will raise their hand real quick so everybody knows who works here as well, you can also talk to any of these folks. They can certainly help you as well. What else? What other bits of news? So these are scheduled to end at 5. There's a movement afoot to go to the lodge downtown on Orange Avenue and have a few celebration drinks, it looks like. So everyone feel free to join in on that. If you are so inclined. So that'll, everyone's going to get there like 5:30-ish or so? Half an hour after, let's say half an hour after the presentation's in? Okay, great. And I think we've got 10 presentations today, Rick, is that right? Okay, so I think, we also have a spillover room in the back where this is being live streamed as well. So hopefully we don't have to violate any of the fire marshal rules to have everybody enjoy this, but so there's a few more seats in here available. There's also a spillover in the back if you're showing up late. And we are live streaming this, and we are recording this as well, so we'll make those available in some manner afterwards as well. That's about, I think, all I have. So I'm going to introduce Rick Hall. Rick's our production director here, and he's going to give us a little more info on what's going to happen for the rest of the day.
Well, welcome to the 9th annual Capstone Pitch Day. You know, we found that pretty much every year that we do this, the pitches seem to get better, and high hopes are going to be even better this year than last year. But with Nick now making a part of the program, we have actual artists attached to every pitch. I think they're going to be good. I passed out to all the students a scoring sheet that contains the name of the designer of each game and the name of the game. It's got a little section for notes and a little section at the end for ratings. What you need to do is take notes as you're watching each pitch of what you like, what you didn't like about the game. I would hold back on giving it a rating until the very end, because at the end you're going to want to compare everything that you've seen and rate them from 1 to 10, no duplicates, only 1-1, only 1-2. And then what we'll do is we will take these score sheets back to MI6 after it's all over, and we'll score them up, and just like golf, the low score is the winner. The faculty will figure out how many projects that we can support and assign everybody to the appropriate teams, and then sometime tonight, I don't know how late it'll be, but sometime tonight we'll send out an email to everyone at FIEA, and you'll see who the winners are, and you'll see which team you are on. These presentations are going to be 25 minutes long apiece. I don't expect each presentation to be 25 minutes. They'll probably be more like 10 or 15, and then there's some time for Q&A afterwards. Anybody in the room is welcome to ask questions, any question you want. We will cut it off at 25 minutes, and then there'll be a little five-minute break between each presentation for equipment changes. We'll see how the timing goes. If there's time in the middle for us to take a little 15-minute break, we will, but if we're running too far behind schedule, we won't. So I think that's about all we have to announce. So if anybody has any questions about anything, you know, you can see me between presentations. But for now, I'm just going to turn it over to Drew and our very first capstone pitch. Drew now.
Hello everyone, my name is Drew Napoli, and I'm here to pitch my game to you all. But before we start off, I think we should start off with a little question to get ourselves in the mood of Capstone. And basically, I want you all to think about what are your favorite types of moments in video games? We all got here to FIEA to build games because of these types of moments. When we're looking at these games and thinking about them, keep in the back of your mind, what are these moments that you enjoy so much? For me, the moments I enjoy is kind of developing a little relationship with an AI partner that you're playing with, almost feeling like your friends a little bit, and then, it's weird, but having them die, something tragic kind of happening. I love it. Every single time I think about favorite moments, that's there. So I want you to all meet Cass right now. Cass is a dear friend of mine from Fallout New Vegas, and you can see we met at a restaurant right there, this is us over there. We went to the Grand Canyon, towards us taking a picture. I Instagrammed a picture of her right there. We had a great time together. And as we were patrolling the wasteland, as we were so often to do, we came across the band camp, and we just were taking it out as we normally do. But she got shot, she went down, and I was a little distraught at first, but I was like, it's okay, I have my saving. So I go into my load screen, and something tragic happened. My save game were not working, they were not loading up, and so now I had this moment where I'm like, do I replay 5 hours again, or do I go on without pass with my dearest friend? And I made the really tough decision to go on without pass. The rest of the game I was playing, I was like, Cass will love this site. And my girlfriend's like, who's Cassie? I'm like, you would not understand, okay? But that it was such a unique feeling in a game because of this lack of a save function that crept on me, essentially. I got to feel this unique sense of loss, and it all being my fault. And I had to soldier on without my favorite AI partner throughout the game, and it really weighed on me. And so that's the main emotion I want to bring into the game called Knights of the Round.
And you might be looking at this picture right now being, whoa, what's with all the neon lights? What's with the sparks? What's with the Tron? Who put Tron in My King Arthur? That's what you're saying to yourself right now. So we sat down with the pitch team, and we were discussing a lot of options about what we wanted in this game. And we really loved the fiction of King Arthur and what it represented in a theme of characters. We felt a little bit strained about the medieval setting, and we wanted to flex our creative muscles and how we present the story, what sort of abilities we give the characters, and the art style. So after exploring a few different types of ideas, we settled on a sci-fi theme to retell this King Arthur story in. And we can retell the story without really betraying what King Arthur is. So it also gives us a great sci-fi meets a medieval art style. So like, that guy just looks cool right there. He's got this armor and the glowy lights, and it's a unique blend of the two styles. So the environments here are kind of, it's Camelot. So those of you know Camelot, it's an ideal place. It's King Arthur, it's setting up perfection on Earth in the middle of the Dark Ages. So it's supposed to be a livable place, it's a space station. It's a livable place that is beautiful, it's ideal. But as we're going to go into it a little bit, you notice it's utopian on the cusp of dystopian. We're going to go to the story real quick. So the original story, as you all know, is it's about the Dark Ages. It's about a brief moment of light and low of the Dark Ages. The reason why the Dark Ages happened is the world falls out of England. The order that was normally there is gone. Chaos ensues until man, named Arthur, comes and establishes his order, establishes Camelot. He's betrayed, he dies, chaos resumes. In our story, it's something similar. We're not betraying anything of what King Arthur is. So humans spread out amongst the stars, inhabit all the galaxy. But one day, they lose contact with Earth. And that order and stability that the galaxy depended on is gone. So this dark age sort of exists now. And as one of those false lights in the galaxy, a man named Arthur comes and brings peace. He establishes Camelot. That's our space station. Arthur is forced to, just like in the original story, Arthur is forced to leave Camelot to pursue Lancelot for his betrayal. And then his illegitimate son, Mordred, comes and claims the throne. He says, I'm the ruler of Camelot now. And this is where our story starts. It begins with Arthur off. He's not even in our game. Mordred is hunting down everyone in Camelot still loyal to King Arthur. You are a member of the Knights of the Round Table, and your only objective in this game is to escape Camelot in order that you can warn King Arthur eventually. So you're going to be starting off in the Round Table room, traveling through Camelot to escape and eventually obtaining a ship and leaving. These are our characters right here. These are our Pendragons, as we call them. We have four iconic members of the Knights of the Round Table. We have Percival, we have Gawain, we have Solance, which is actually a real member, the only female member of the Knights of the Round Table. And we have Galahad over there. All these knights, they can move, they can shoot, they can take cover, they can melee with their own swords, and they'll take commands from you, the leader. So let's go briefly through each one. We have Galahad, he's secure, the most righteous of the group. He's the protector of the group. Some of his abilities are to cast a giant shield around himself and protect those that he cares about, the other team, his team. He can stun people with EMP blasts, and he has a melee stun attack when he goes up in close. We have Solance. She's arguably the most deadly in the group. She has a sarcastic and a dry wit. She can move about the battlefield very quickly. She can teleport. She can snipe and take out someone from far away. And she has a fast melee attack. We have Percival. He's loud. He's boisterous. He's also a bit of a hacker of the group. He can do a hologram decoy, which can distract other members of the enemy team and have them attack the decoy. He can also hack enemy turrets and enemy robots. And when he attacks in melee, kind of taunts and draws other enemies to his position. And lastly, we have Gawain. Gawain is the leader. The leader is you. And his strongest weapon is the knights around him. We actually want to nerf our main player character a little bit because we want the player to feel that they cannot solo this adventure. They really rely on those around them to be able to conquer these obstacles. And we gave him abilities, lesser versions of the same abilities that the other knights have. So we have an EMP blast, a hack, and a teleport ability for him. But we really want the player to feel that their main weapon is the knights and how they guide and navigate through this. We also have some enemies, just to briefly go over them. The enemies, they make the standard, the same way as the knights. They can move, they can shoot, they can take cover. We also have enemy knights that have some of the same abilities that your own knights have. And since this is a game about leadership and about meeting them, we also wanted to include the ability of enemy leaders. And if you can take out these enemy leaders, the Knights of Day command will also start to behave more erratically because they don't have those same commands coming down from the chain. So the gameplay is a third-person tactical action game. It's almost like a real-time XCOM is what we're going for. you'll be leaving your nights against overwhelming odds. We don't want this to be a situation where you walk into a room and there's 20 bad guys, 15 bad guys, and you just defeat them all and move over to the next stage. We want it to be about you enter an environment, you survey the field, decide about how you want to cut through this environment to get to the other side. If you can get through there with only killing a few people, that's great. You don't need to feel like you need to sit there and destroy everyone. It's about using your knights effectively. It's about using their abilities effectively and trying to minimize the risk to your knights. These choices are not going to come through a list like a mass effect or a dialogue choice. They're going to be organic in the environment by having multiple objectives, like I was saying. So the level design is going to be very important in this game. So for instance, there could be a turret in a level that's guarding a middle pathway. And you could walk through the middle of the pathway, but there's a turret there, it's going to take you out. So maybe one idea is you can do is you can go and either take out the turret, you can have Galahad stun the turret, you can have Percival hack the turret and make it switch sides on you. There could be an enemy leader somewhere else in the field on another route. You can have Salons teleport over there, you can have Salons snipe there, you can move up there slowly, you can use Galahad to use as a protection shield as you slowly move up the battlefield. Another instance you had, we thought was pretty cool, was Galahad. Since Galahad is this pure and gallant knight, we felt that if he walked into an environment and there were civilians being attacked, what would he do? Would he sit there and listen to your orders and say, oh, let's go take out this turret? Or would he say, no, we need to go protect these. We need to go protect these civilians. Would he stop listening to them? Would he go off on his own and try and protect these civilians? And now you're presented with another choice. Do you disregard him running off to protect these civilians because you think taking out the turrets is more important? Or do you want to protect Galahad as he's trying to take out these civilians so that he doesn't die, so he doesn't get in trouble? So we want to have all these types of choices come out through the level design. And like I said earlier, like the past, I lost her. And we want to bring that sort of death to this game. So if you're not taking care of your knights, they can die eventually. But we don't want it to be so you walk into an environment and they get cheap shotted and Galahad is dead and out the rest of them. We want it to be somewhat fair. We want it to be they'll go down, you can revive them back up. But what we thought was really cool with this is if you have Salons on the other side of the field and she's doing something and she goes down, you're near the exit of the environment. What do? You try and go back and save her then? Or do you leave her there knowing that you'll lose her and that she'll die? I think it provides like a really neat choice that the player has to make. So this game does have some challenges that I just want to discuss. Does need a robust AI system. We would like to build this out so that both your enemy knights are intelligent and they act accordingly and they listen to your orders in the way you feel that they should, but also the enemy knights. That they feel like they're reacting to your very own movements. That when you take that the leaders, the knights of the leader act more intelligent. When you take out the leader, they'll act less intelligently. Blending of two art styles. Challenge looks cool. It's not. We looked on the internet, and there's some reference to art boy this type of style, but there's not a lot. So you really require people to bring this to life. This type of environment, this Camelot to life. We want to develop these characters so people care. If no one cares about these characters, it doesn't really matter if you have to leave Salons behind. Maybe she was annoying or whatever. But we want people to feel torn when they have to make these choices. We don't want them to feel comfortable. And lastly, it's really going to require creative level design to encourage these types of special moments in the game when you're coming to something you're like, what do I do? Do I do this? Do I do that? Do I go up the center? Do I go on the side? What are my risks and what are my rewards? I think if creative level design can really bring these special moments, these choices, to the forefront of the game. Okay, we're going to launch into a Q&A session in a little bit, but before that, I just want to show you a little mood video that shows things about leadership, teamwork, and loss.
You were young and your heart was an open book. You used to say, live and let live. But if this ever-changing world you wish we live in makes you give in a cry, say, live and let die. Live and let die.
Because you'll be kind of playing the leader, how will you be able to maintain enough player control while having enough independent AI amongst your squad? You talked about one of the characters who would run off and go assist the civilians. Mm-hmm. How are you going to be able to either, I guess I would use the term reprimand, or control them? And at what point are they just going to blatantly ignore you?
Sure, so that example with Galahad one is an instance where you actually do lose control of Galahad. But for the most part, the way we envision it is you enter to an area, and you can, on your button on your controller or computer, you hit it, and it brings up, you can order your troops around the field. This time will slow down, you can look at an environment, say, go there, use that ability on that guy. But that's how we're envisioning how it controls. Is that kind of what you're asking? How you manage your troops and how you
around
the field?
How do you balance that pillar of enough player control over the squad and enough squad independency?
You want to make sure that's part of the AI challenge. So we want to make sure that you do get to the direction. You don't want Galahad or Slant just running off in a random direction. But you want them sticking by your side, essentially, until they're needed. And they'll act intelligently in a small little area, and then when you say, go over there, you want them to make sure that they act intelligently in that small little area without having them just run off in some random direction. Because, I think that's what we'd have to, they listen to your commands, they'll go to the locations that you want them to go to, but in the little areas that they go to, they act intelligently. Tom?
Yeah, based on your research into how you're going to make the mechanic work, how many complete levels do you envision really doing for the project?
That's a good question. So we kind of envision this as one giant level, because we kept scope in the very forefront of our minds when thinking about this. So we didn't think about it in terms of, since we thought about it in terms of one level, we thought about it in terms of encounters, and each encounter being this arena where you enter into and you have to escape from, and just start at the very beginning and get to the end. And these arenas are nice because they can be flexible in size. You can make them large if the team's able to, you can make them smaller if you're able to. The way we had it planned out in this one, we had three arenas, there being immediately outside the round table room, kind of in the courtyard of the castle. Then again, that's kind of the civilian section where people were living. And then lastly, in like a hangar bay type area, trying to get to the ship. That's what we envisioned, kind of three significant combat arenas. But then again, if the team is able to make this larger, if they're saying we have more resources and we have more time, they can expand this and they can shrink it too. It's whatever, we wanted to make it flexible in that way.
Cool, thank you.
Yeah. So similar question, but more related to characters. Mm-hmm. How many unique characters can you envision? Do they have facial animation?
Sure. Well, we envision significant characters being the four knights, yourself, and three with you. For the facial animation stuff, we'd like to have facial animation for these characters. But the nice thing with enemy characters or any other type of characters, if facial animation is becoming an issue or a problem, the nice thing is knight helmets. I mean, we saw those enemies; they have their own little knightly helmets on there. So it'd be cool to do these things with facial animations. But the nice thing is if that ever really does become a problem, we can mitigate that by having them wear their masks, their armor on their head.
I have an online question.
Oh, all right.
Feels like a, some kind of MTV.
That's cool.
Yes, sort of like MTV shows.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How would the game handle a bad player?
How would the game handle a bad player? Yeah. You want to make, when you walk in, and it just takes out all of your
right.
All of your guys right away. There's things that you can do programmatically, I think, to limit that and kind of author the experience a little bit more and not make it so freeform. So, for instance, we were saying we have three areas, we have three knights that you're with. Playtesting knows that this was a problem. What you could do is you can kind of limit the damage and say only one knight can die per area, perhaps. But then again, you have a lot of that aspect of leaving another enemy knight behind. So it would probably take a lot of playtesting and adjustments in the AI as you're playing to notice that, hey, you're really not doing so hot right now. You probably need to lessen up on the player and let them get through this environment. Jacob?
Building a character relationship would take time. As in, like, with cats, you've been playing that character for a long time. In a game as short as this, how do you get the players to fall in love with the characters in time for them to die?
Sure. I don't think you need a lot of time to fall in love with the character. A great example of this is, how many people saw the movie Up here? I went to that movie, I was popcorn, I was ready to see a cool flick and laugh at some Disney lines. I sat down, and within the first 2 minutes of that movie, I was crying. Within 2 minutes, I had connected with this character, I had established a rapport, and they beat me over the head with it, and I was in tears. And commercials do this all the time, too. So the whole point is to make you empathize with these characters in commercials. By the end of it, you're like, I get this. I know what he's feeling, and I'm going to buy this product now. So I don't think you need a lot of time, actually, to establish a relationship with the character. I think if it's done smartly and wisely, you can do it in a very quick amount of time.
Okay. What was the name of the movie where all you fall into the ice?
That was King Arthur.
Is it routine, or do you just like kill the man?
I saw it in 2004. Jesse just saw it recently.
Yeah.
Saw that?
It's not worth it.
They do pull a guy out of ice.
They do pull up through that ice.
They do pull up through the ice.
What?
They have kind of happened like multiple endings, sort of like where your team makes it or.
Well, I mean, that's something, yeah, you don't want to be, if most of the team doesn't get that, maybe it's only you and another night, you want to be like, all right, everything's cool right now. Like, you do want them to react limitedly to what's happening around them. You can't go crazy with this, because I think there's about 8 or 9 different permutations of the amount of nights that can be available to you at any given time. So you don't want to go too wild, but yeah, there would be some different endings about how you accomplish this.
How much of your gameplay is going to be like squad interaction and command?
I think a lot of the game is going to be kind of squad interactions. Like I said, we do want the player to be autonomous. We do want them to have the ability to attack, to use their abilities, to shoot. We do really want the player to feel like their strongest weapon is these knights that they have. To really get an idea of leadership. Like, Gawain himself is not the strongest by any stretch. These three knights around him are the strongest. And the point is to use them effectively in these combat situations. So I think a big portion is going to be navigating or using the knights you have to navigate the environments. Right. We have one more question? Okay. David in the back. Well, I think that's a good question. You do want a robust kind of AI system in this thing. But to say that the AI won't work, AI in almost every game is somewhat of an expectation that it should work. I think most of the games that we pitch you today will have some sort of AI. Well, like you were saying, we do want a more robust AI system. And if that's not something that programs are able to achieve, we can scale back and bring it back down to a more standard type of AI system that we probably just have to cheat the code. All right, thank you. All right.
If you leave the room and you come back later than 12 o'clock, we'll be able to back door.
I was trying to do this.
I don't know what's going on. What happened there?
I think I know a reason why I'm not looking at it. So we need a better control.